So often, and I'm guilty of this too, a lot of beginner runners, or not even beginner runners, more advanced runners who've been running for years will say, my first kilometer is my warm-up.
Right.
So what does, what would a running warm-up kind of look like? Because even the most experienced runners don't necessarily showcase what they do to warm up or even cool down for that matter.
Right.
Yeah.
Good question. I think I think a big factor in what a running, the purpose of the warm-up is and what it might look like depends on the type of training session you're going to do or race for that matter.
Yeah.
You know, I think the performance side of things, if you're trying to optimize what you're going to get out of your body, I think having a warm-up that's not just the first kilometer, that has some deliberate drills that are going to help you work on your technique, make your running stride more efficient, that's very helpful. A lot of people don't really think about the fact that they're fighting themselves. Their body is not working in the direction they want to go. We're over-rotating sometimes. We could be putting the brakes on by overextending our stride. There's a lot of technical things that could happen in a running stride that you can learn a little bit about.
Right.
Then take the time when you're focused a little bit to actually work on it. It's hard when you're running to work on the details of the technique. You can do it. People can do it. But you have to develop things, I would say, in a more controlled scenario. And you're going to benefit from having the technique broken down into parts before you start to piece it all together. In the beginning, you might not have it sort of lined up in your head what you need to do, but as you start to get out there more frequently, develop your routine, that warm-up becomes a big piece of what you're doing. I know a lot of runners, you know, from relative beginner novice runners to elite runners, where that's sort of a ritual that they don't want to get away from, because mentally there's a lot going on in a race. There's a lot of things to think about. It can be intimidating for some people, because if you're, you know, running by yourself on a quiet street or on sidewalks in the community when there's not much going on, and then all of a sudden there's 5,000 people around you, it can get intimidating, So you need to just focus on what you want to do. When the starter goes off in the race, it's really easy to see people take off.
Right.
But you want to be able to use your warm-up to concentrate on what you need to focus on. You know, be present with what's happening and enjoy what's happening, because really that's part of the fun, is being in that environment, but not letting that environment take over your emotions and overwhelm you with what's going on. So that warm-up piece is have a routine, have a plan that you're going to follow to prepare yourself, and go through it like it's a ritual, and that gets you to that start
makes
line.
Makes you more comfortable to get to that start line.
Yes, definitely.
What sort of factors should people be considering when we're talking about warm up and cool down? We can talk about cool down after too, but what sort of factors should they be considering? Like, what parts of the body would they want to warm up, or like, you know, for, I'm assuming it depends on the length of the distance of the race, but what sort of things should they consider when warming up?
Yeah, I would say a big factor is intensity.
Intensity, okay.
And by intensity, that in a running context is speed. So that's gonna play into how you map out your warm up in terms of time, in terms of progressing from a lower intensity to a higher intensity.
Yeah.
But you know, you want to start general, just to kind of get some blood flow, just easy. Some people, depending on your fitness level, that's gonna be a major factor, what your baseline fitness level is in a running context, right? Because you could be you could be a lifter, a good fit strength athlete, but not so much a runner. So then you're starting differently.
Right.
But having that, increasing the blood flow, whether it's walking, whether it's an easy jog, could even be hopping on a bike or like a stationary bike or something else that just allows you to get the blood flowing.
Right.
That's good. Right. I think that's a good starting point. From there, once the blood starts to flow, that's basically increasing the energy stores coming into the working muscles, so they're readily available. Otherwise, you're not going to have them readily available when you actually start your run, so then your body is delayed in getting the fuel it needs to fuel the run.
Right, okay.
And can lead to some fatigue elements coming in too early.
Yeah, yeah.
But then getting into some of those drills, right? You know, we're gonna talk about some drills,
yes,
right? We're gonna go through some drills and just practicing the elements specifically or more skewed to the lower body. Obviously running is much more lower body than it is upper body.
Yeah, for sure.
But we still need to map the upper body part with the lower body and make sure there's not too much noise
and between the
exactly okay, having okay. it clean, having that opposing arm and leg movement working together, working efficiently, and
right. okay.
and doing our best to eliminate pieces that cause us to work against our own body.
Right.
All right. So what we're going through here is just a simple, easy jog. Intensity's low. He should be able to carry a conversation, get a full sentence or more out without having to gasp for the air. So right. we really want to keep that intensity low for this easy jog. From there, we're going to be focusing on some running drills. So there's sort of a sequence of running drills. You may have seen this when you were playing other sports mm-hmm. in high school. You may have never seen it ever.
Right.
But basically we have, for our drills, we have our knee drive, which is the knee coming up from the ground. We have our foot contact. That's where the foot's then returning back down to the ground. And then we have the recovery. So, you know, we name this very simple.
Right.
A is the knee drive, B is the foot contact, C is the recovery. So you might hear people talking about doing their A's, B's, and C's. So it's a very basic running technique piece. It is focused on the ground, or sorry, not the ground, but the lower body half.
Right.
But we're also bringing our arms into the mix and making sure that they're working with the lower half as right. we go along. After we go through our technical drills, it's really good to allow yourself to put it all together and progress to your desired pace. So depending on the distance you're running, you may get people to do anywhere from 50 meters to 100 or 200 meters of just feeling out the pace. And if you're, let's just say 100% of your race pace, so whatever right. that is, it could be 5 minutes per kilometer, it could be 6 minutes per kilometer, it could be four. But that's what we're working up to. Say it's 5 minutes per kilometer.
Right.
We're gonna start doing a few of those shorter lengths and just trying to be as smooth and efficient as we can. Each round we're gonna get a little bit faster and okay. then we're gonna work up to that desired race pace where we feel, or desired workout pace where we feel what that is.
Right.
And we're checking that with our watch if we have it, or some sort of way of measuring.
Right, right? Okay, okay.
If you have a distance, you can check the total time if you can do the math on that. Otherwise, having a GPS watch just makes life easier.
Yeah, it makes right? it easier. Yeah, yeah, for sure. Okay. What about a cool down? What would a cool down look like? And what are the factors we'd want to consider when we're cooling down?
Sure. I would say for the majority of running distances, like speed, sprinting, all the way up to the longer distances like your marathon and beyond, you really want to start recirculating the blood.
Okay.
Anyone who's done that will always speak about their heavy legs and
right.
sort of that blood flow being pushed to your legs just to bring the energy and the oxygen to the working muscles
right.
to fuel that activity. So you're going to want to do some light movement. For some of us,
okay.
it might just start as walking and continually walking. A lot
right.
of people have a tendency to sit down or lay down.
Yeah.
And at the very end of especially harder workouts or races,
right.
that's not a good idea.
You can't get back up.
You might not get back up. You might
yeah.
you might not be awake, right? You might
right,
you
right.
might completely pass out because the oxygen disappears from your brain.
Right.
So part of, a lot of people don't realize this, is that we actually have valves in our veins that allow for blood to return back up to the level of the heart. So every time you are taking a step and walking, or jogging lightly for that matter, but let's use walking as the example, each step pushes the muscle up, or the blood up a little bit in the muscle, and then it gets stuck in the valve and it keeps moving up towards your heart. So that's
right.
very robotic in the idea, but it happens very naturally and more smoothly in your body as you're taking your steps. So that
right.
allows the recirculation of blood, which allows the oxygen that's coming in from your lungs to then go back down there and support aerobic metabolism, which is a big factor in our recovery post-activity.
Right.
And then in terms of how you would structure a cool down, doing that sort of light aerobic to recirculate is great. Going through a few dynamic stretches
okay,
is nice.
Dynamic as opposed to static. So you don't want to be sitting there in a seated fold or like a pigeon, like you don't want to be holding a long thing.
Not initially. Not initially. Like you would want to just recirculate the blood and allow the heart rate to come down a little bit before you get into some of those static folds.
Okay. Hit us with a few dynamic.
So it could be just as simple as just walking, bringing your knees up, alternating every 3 to 5 steps. It could be bringing your heels back. It could be walking, getting a little bit of an external or an internal rotation in your hip. A lot of things that are slow, just trying to reestablish the full range of motion in your key joints that were involved, continually facilitating that blood flow and that return to rest. So we're not doing it the same way we would for our warm up, where we're sort of amping ourselves up. We're doing it slower over time, more gradual and deliberate in our movements, as we're allowing the heart rate and the intensity of the body to come down and come back to that resting state.
Right.
Once you get close to baseline, you know, somewhere near 100 beats per minute, everybody's going to be a little bit different, but somewhere near that sort of resting state post exercise, post run, then you can adapt or adopt some of those more static stretching positions.
Okay, so the biggest indicator to go to the static stretch or be out of kind of like the danger zone where you could maybe have a seat on the floor and have a seated knee hug or something like that, that would be your heart rate.
Yeah.
That would be your heart rate.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And a lot of people will speak to their respiration as well, like the really heavy breathing.
If
you're breathing too heavy, then you probably are not in a position to hold stretches safely and effectively,
because
your body's going to focus and prioritize the oxygen.
Right, okay.
So you would want to make sure both your heart rate and respiration go down. You're going to want to make sure that the blood flow to the muscles that you're stretching is not super tight muscle pump. You don't want it to be very inflated, which does happen for especially harder bouts or longer races.
And
by longer, I mean relative to yourself. You know, if you've never run a 5K, that's a longer race.
So
don't say if you can't run a marathon, you're not running long.
Right.
It's all relative.
Yeah.
So you just got to be mindful of that. There's no exact science to these things, but you need to be in a relatively rested, recovered state before you go to these stretches. I usually try to avoid people getting into stretches where they're inverted, where their head's down below.
Right, okay.
Just because there's a tendency for people to lose consciousness if they're not used to that. There's many stretches that can be done in a more upright position to target the key hips, quads, hamstrings, calves of the body or the running muscles that we would be using.